go. Good morning, Grace Family Church. Why don't you turn to someone, say hi, give them a high five. There we go. Okay, you can turn to your second choice now and give them a hello. There we go. My mother-in-law's encouragement this morning was, don't mess it up, Tom. So there we go. But we're really excited to be here. And I want to start by asking you this question. And the question is, how many of you are tired of waiting? Tired of waiting for things to get better. I see that hand. Tired of waiting for people to sort their stuff out. I can say whatever I want because I'm going soon, bro. You can send your emails to Wayne. You know what I mean? Waiting for recognition, waiting for the deal to go through, waiting for the weight to come off, the diagnosis to be clear, the healing to happen, praying prayers, maybe a little more seriously, praying prayers like the psalmist prayed thousands of years ago. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? I love the Bible because it's so raw, it's so real. The psalmist pours his heart out, and God is not threatened by those kinds of outpourings. And you know, to be honest, you know, I'm a pastor and all that, but sometimes I look around at the world and I look at the problems and I think, God, where are you? God, what are you doing? I mean, are you seeing this? Wars and fighting and dysfunction and children being killed and ripped from their homes and brokenness and pain and death and... God, why aren't you doing something about these problems? Why aren't you doing something about my problems? If you've ever thought that or asked that or wrestled with those kinds of questions, today I want to breathe hope into you this morning. The title of my message is Here and Now. Say Here and Now. And it comes, oh, you're much better than the first service. Those folks were still waking up. Okay. And this here and now comes from a line in John chapter 11, verse 25. And he's speaking to Martha, and Jesus says this. He says, Martha, you don't have to wait for the end. I am right now resurrection and life. Now the context, and we're going to dive a little deeper into it this morning, but the context is that Martha's brother, Lazarus, has died. She's mourning his loss. She's grieving. She's hurting. She's angry. And she says this to Jesus. She says, Master, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Can you sense her words are laced with pain, even accusation? But even in the midst of that, she still has faith, enough faith to say, even now, Jesus, I know that whatever you ask, God will give you. And Jesus responds to her, your brother will be raised up. And Martha says, I know you'll be raised up at the resurrection at the end of time. And let me pause there in the story because this was a response. This was a common response that Martha was giving. And I think it's a common response that many people give today. You see, if not most people, many people still believe in some kind of afterlife. Whether you're Christian or not, most people I speak to believe in some kind of spiritual reality that exists beyond this physical reality, what they can see, touch, taste, and feel. They may not call it heaven or even have language for it, but there's a sense of openness towards the spiritual in some form. And so the problem with most people is not this belief in an afterlife or the then or the that. The problem is, what about now? Because now is my reality. Now is your reality. Now I got bills to pay. Now I'm going through a divorce. Now I got to raise my kids. Now I'm fighting with my spouse. Now I've got to go to work. Heaven at the end, it sounds great with all of that. But what about now, God? On the other hand, you have some people, and Christians are usually the worst at this, who live only for the then. They live as if now doesn't matter at all. And in that sort of framework, they see the world essentially as going to hell in a handbasket. And our job as Christians is to separate ourselves from the world and to be set apart and holy and sort of isolate ourselves until one day when we get to heaven. Like we're in this sort of big waiting room waiting to die. Now, personally, I don't connect with that view. Firstly, one, because I think it's unbiblical. And two, because it's such a waste of the gift that this life is, that Jesus literally gave up his life for. You see, the kingdom of God that Jesus speaks so much about is both a now and a then reality. Theologians sometimes refer to it as a now and a not yet reality. Yes, our eternity as followers of Christ is secured in Jesus for sure, but we are also called to bring the kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Are you with me? Jesus says, you don't have to wait for the end. I am right now resurrection and life. In other words, the kingdom life that I am offering you starts now. Here and now, in the midst of all the stuff going on in our world and in your world. Now, as you may or may not be aware, we're in week 5 of a series that we've called Hope Has a Name, and it's essentially based off the 7 statements of Jesus that Jesus makes in John's gospel. And if you haven't been around, let me remind you what those statements are. Jesus says, I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the bread of life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine. And then the one we're looking at today, I am the resurrection and the life. And each one of those statements carries with it such a sense of hope. So much truth. That's why we've called the series Hope Has a Name. Hope is a person, and the person is Jesus. And maybe you've heard all those statements before, maybe you've heard none of them, but understanding when and where and to whom those statements were made is very important, because I think it helps to bring life to those already powerful words. And I've given you some context for the statement Jesus makes about I am the resurrection and life, but I want to do a deep dive today into John chapter 11, because the story in which Jesus makes the statement is just as important as the statement that he makes. And there are so many little details in this story that I think can help us, you and I, to, in our own struggles, in our own questions, in our own doubts, in our own waiting, and in our own here and now. So are you ready? My mother-in-law is ready, and 2 other people. Okay. Let's get back to John chapter 11, starting in verse 1, and I'm going to kind of work my way all the way through. A man was sick. I got my notes here, but you can read on the screen. A man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. This was the same Mary who massaged the Lord's feet with aromatic oils and then wiped them with her hair. It was her brother Lazarus who was sick. So the sisters sent word to Jesus. They're desperate. They know Jesus can help. Master, the one you love so very much is sick. And when Jesus got the message, he said, "The sickness is not fatal. It will become an occasion to show God's glory by glorifying God's Son." Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. But oddly, when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed on where he was for 2 more days. Now, the question that I ask when I read the text is, why didn't Jesus go to Lazarus immediately? Did Jesus already know what was going to happen? It would seem so from the way the text is written, but this was written years afterwards, so maybe it's referring back. But even so, he still says, hey, this is not fatal, but we know Lazarus died. So what's the deal with that? And even still, we look back and understand the story, but if I'm sure if you were Mary or Martha or Lazarus for that matter, this would have felt like a pretty cold response from Jesus. Like, Jesus, why won't you come? Don't you even care? It reminds me of the disciples in the boat in the storm when Jesus is having a nap in the boat and the disciples trying to wake him and say, Jesus, don't you even care if we drown? Ever thought that? Ever prayed that? God, why aren't you fixing this? God, why aren't you answering my prayer? Don't you even care? Eventually, Jesus does decide to go. It says this, after 2 days, he said to his disciples, let's go back to Judea. And they said, Rabbi, you can't do that. The Jews are out to kill you, and you're going back. In other words, are you mad? And Jesus responds, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in daylight doesn't stumble because there's plenty of light from the sun. Walking at night, he might very well stumble because he can't see where he's going. Now, I'm not going to get into the detail of this particular part of the passage, but he's essentially referring to himself as the light of the world. But he carries on. He says, he said these things and then announced, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep. I am going to wake him up." The disciples said, I mean, they're not the smartest bunch, the disciples. He said, "Master, if he's gone to sleep, he'll get a good rest and wake up feeling fine." Like, what's the problem? And then Jesus has to spell it out. He says, "Lazarus has died. And I'm glad for your sakes that I wasn't there, because you're about to be given new grounds for believing." I love that statement, new grounds for believing. All of us need new grounds for believing. Now let's go to him. And that's when Thomas, the one called the twin, said to his companions, "Come along, we might as well go die with him." I love Thomas. Not just because he's got a cool name, but I think, you know, Thomas was a pretty all-in guy. You know what I mean? This is the guy who, after Jesus' resurrection and death and resurrection, he's like, "Unless I see him, unless I stick my finger in his side, I ain't believing nothing." You know, doubting Thomas. And he starts off this passage by saying, "Jesus, you can't go to Judea. You're going to get killed," to kind of like, "Okay, fine, let's go die with him." You know what I mean? This is the guy you want on your team and in the trenches with you. The story goes on. When Jesus finally got there, he found Lazarus already 4 days dead. Remember, it takes time to travel by foot in that part of the world. And then it says this, Bethany was near Jerusalem, only a couple of miles away, and many of the Jews were visiting Mary and Martha, sympathizing with them over their brother. Martha heard Jesus was coming and went out to meet him. Mary remained in the house. Now, that's interesting because the roles are switched around here from last time Mary and Martha had an interaction with Jesus. I'm not sure if there's significance to that. But now we see this. Martha says, and this is what we read earlier, "If you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died. God, where were you?" But then Mary's faith pushes through. Like I said, she says, "Even now," or even though this is terrible, "even though my heart is broken, even though I can't see a way through my tears, through my grief, through my pain, I will trust in you, Lord." She says, "Even now, I know whatever you ask, God will give you." Even now, say, "Even now. I don't know what you're going through." But sometimes when we're in our deepest, darkest place, when things around us or inside of us are dead, the only thing we can do is trust in the one who says, "I am the resurrection and the life." Jesus says, "Your brother will be raised up." And we read this earlier. "I know that he'll be raised up at the resurrection at the end of time." And Jesus says, "You don't have to wait till the end, Martha. I am right now resurrection and life. The one who believes in me," he goes on, "even though he or she dies, will live. And everyone who lives believing in me does not ultimately die at all." This is the hope we have in Jesus. And then he says, "Do you believe this? Do you believe this?" I mean, this is the question we must all wrestle with at some point in our lives, whether we are seeking in our faith, whether we call ourselves Christian or not. We answer this question: do you believe this? And Martha's response is clear: "Yes, Master. All along, I have believed that you are the Messiah, the Son of God who comes into the world." After saying this, she went to her sister Mary and whispered in her ear, "The teacher is here and is asking for you." The moment Mary heard that, she jumps up, she ran out to Jesus. And Jesus had not yet entered into the town, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When her sympathizing Jewish friends saw Mary run off, they followed her, thinking she was on her way to the tomb to weep there. Mary came to where Jesus was waiting and fell at his feet, saying, "Master, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died." There it is again. Mary too carries pain. Mary too carries disappointment. "Jesus, why didn't you prevent this from happening? I know you could have." But this time Jesus' response is a little different. It says, when Jesus saw her sobbing and the Jews with her sobbing, a deep anger welled up within him. And he said, "Where did you put him?" "Master, come and see," they said. And then this line, "Now Jesus wept." I'm reading to you today from the Message transliteration, but in the original Greek, it's just two words, that sentence. It just says, "He wept." He wept. It's the shortest sentence in the entire Bible. it's also possibly the most profound. The day God cried. And the Greek, the word here for wept, I've preached this before, the word here for wept is actually better translated as sobbed or bawled. In other words, Jesus was wrecked. He was wrecked by the death of his friend. Wrecked when he saw the pain that his family was in. I mean, even yesterday, a man who was an elder for many, many years in this church, youngest son, was killed in a car accident yesterday. Jesus wept. And then there are two types of responses. It's so interesting. Two groups of people. The one respond, look how deeply he loved him. The other group, well, if he loved him so much, why didn't he do something about it? After all, he opened the eyes of the blind man. Can I just pause there and say this? Wherever you might find yourself in your own journey of faith, whatever struggles you might be going through, surround yourself with people in the first bunch. Surround yourself with people in your life who are able to understand and empathize and sit with you in your pain. Not try and explain it away, or because I'm telling you, there are always going to be the other bunch in your life. The bystanders and the naysayers. Well, if he loved him so much, why didn't he do something? I mean, he healed that guy. What about me? What about them? What about ism? And I've heard Christians say this stuff, and it's well-meaning. I get it, but it can be so hurtful. Hey, I know you're going through a hard time and everything, but you know, you kind of bought it on yourself. Ever heard that? Well, hey, I know you're grieving, but why can't you just move on? It's been a long enough time now, surely. This is when the story gets interesting. It says, then Jesus. I paused that there because those two words say, then Jesus. Because how many of you know you can be in the worst situation imaginable, then Jesus? Amen? Then Jesus came along and my life was never the same. Then Jesus came along and rescued our marriage. Then Jesus came along and that addiction faded away. This is my story. This is many of yours in the room's story. Then Jesus. When you read those two words, you know a miracle is about to happen. Then Jesus, the anger again welling up within him, arrived at the tomb. It was a simple cave in the hillside with a slab of stone laid against it. And Jesus said, remove the stone. Remove the stone. He spoke, and let me remember, this was the Word of God who was at the very beginning, who spoke creation into being. And he says, remove the stone. And it wasn't the first stone he would remove. And I believe he's declaring in this room today, in our lives, remove the stone. The sister of the dead man, Martha, said, Master, by this time there's a stench. He's been dead 4 days. Jesus looked her in the eye. Didn't I tell you if you believed, you would see the glory of God? And then to the others, go ahead, take away the stone. So they removed the stone. And Jesus, I love this, he raised his eyes to heaven and prayed, Father, I'm grateful that you have listened to me. I know you always do listen, but on account of the crowd standing here, I've spoken that they might believe that you have sent me. And can I just remind you, and this takes faith to believe it, especially when you can't see it, but can I remind you, God is listening. God is listening. God has seen your tears, and he has heard your prayers, and he has heard your cries. Jesus says, I'm grateful that you've listened. I know you always do listen. God is always listening. He's always with us. Then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. And he came out, a cadaver wrapped from head to toe and with a kerchief over his face. And Jesus told them, unwrap him and let him loose. Some translations say, unbind him and let him go, let him free. Because Lazarus was still wearing the grave clothes, the kerchief over his head and the grave garments. Are you still with me? This is the story. This is the context for the famous statement, I am the resurrection and the life. And honestly, whether you believe this is a literal statement or a literal story, which I actually do, or a metaphor, it doesn't really matter. Because the point of the story is not about Lazarus. You know Lazarus died, right? Like, not in this story, but he died one day. Someday he died. He's not still walking around going, oh, this is unbelievable. I mean, geez, you know. Everyone Jesus healed died, okay? As we all will do one day. The point is not the death that Lazarus endured. It's the life Jesus offers. That's the point of the story. That's what this message is about. That's what I feel God has called me to tell you today, that Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And it's not some theory. The context of the story is important because he's not standing in a lecture hall talking about I'm the resurrection and the life. No, he's literally standing in a graveyard, in people's suffering, in their pain, and he's saying, I am right here, the resurrection and life. You don't have to wait till the end. You can have that kingdom life right here, right now. So here's the question. If you get nothing else out of this morning, just get this one question, because I think sometimes questions are more powerful than the, you know, questions that we ask are more powerful than the answers that we get. And so here's the question. Write it down, open your phone, put it on your notes, stick it on your fridge, whatever it is. Here's the question. What has died in my life that needs resurrecting? What has died in your life that needs resurrecting? Is it hope? Is it a dream for your future? Have you allowed bitterness or cynicism or doubt or fear to creep in? What about your relationships? Is there a relationship that has gone cold? Have you written some people off? What about your marriage or your business or your mental health? What areas of your life do you need right now the resurrection power of Jesus Christ? Write it down. Write it down. There's something powerful about writing it down. Write it in your journal. Write it on your phone. Pray to God about it. Bring it before him. Bring it out into the light. Bring it out of the tomb like Lazarus. See, here's the thing. There are so many people today, I find it so sad. So many Christians walking around like dead people. Right? I mean, and I include myself in this. We're moving. We're walking around, we're going through the days, we're going to work, we're even coming to church, but there's no life, and there's no spark, and there's no passion, and there's no purpose beyond just our own selves, our own existence. And that is so tragic, because Jesus gave his life so that we could have life and have it in all its mediocrity. Oh no. Jesus gave his life so that we could have life in all its monotony. No. Jesus gave his life so that we could have life in all its fullness, all its abundance. And you say, well, great, Tom, that sounds great, but you don't know my situation. And if you knew, how do I find this abundant life? That's the million-dollar question, right? Well, firstly, I'll say this. You don't find the abundant life. You build one. But besides that, with the limited time that we have left this morning, I want to give you three ideas taken from the text, from Jesus' example, that I think can help us, every single one of us, to grab hold of the resurrection life here and now, to help us go from dead men or dead women walking to alive and thriving. Who wants some of that? Now, let me just give you these 3 points. They all start with the letter S. Because all preachers know that if you don't start your 3 points with the same letter, then the Holy Spirit can't use it, okay? That's just preaching 101, okay? So I've squeezed these in, but just bear with me. So the first is this, sob. Say sob. Before we can walk out of the tomb, we have to acknowledge the death that we're walking out of. Before we can bring healing to a broken world, we have to acknowledge and even sometimes sit in the brokenness. Richard Rohr, a Catholic priest, says, we have to admit that we have been broken before we can be healed. We can't heal until we grieve the events that have wounded us and release the spiritual toxins left behind, opening ourselves to something new. It's why the first step in a 12-step program starts with, I've got a problem. So it's okay to let it out. It's okay to get angry, to get frustrated. It's important to grieve. Jesus was not afraid to grieve. Jesus was not afraid to cry. when he saw the pain that Mary and Martha were in, he wept. And we know in Scripture he wept over Jerusalem, which I'm sure he is still weeping over today, over the pain in Palestine and in Israel and in Jerusalem and in Ukraine and around the world. And he didn't offer, I love this, he didn't offer Mary or Martha theology or an explanation or correction. He simply wept. He didn't say, well, the reason I wasn't here and the reason, hey, who are you to tell me I'm God? I decide, you know. No, he just wept with them. How comforting to know that God weeps with us, that he is with us in our pain. He is with us in the deepest of waters. See, Christianity tells me that not so much that I have an answer for suffering, but rather that I have a companion in it. And I think in the end, that matters far more. So sob, let it out. Cry, weep, grieve, get angry, and then sit with others who are also grieving, who are also going through pain, who are also struggling. And no answers, no theology, no I know how you feel. Don't worry, everything happens for a reason. That is literally the most annoying thing you can say to someone who's, it's like saying to someone, calm down. No one has ever calmed down in the history of someone saying calm down to someone who's not calm. Yes? Okay? No answers. Just presence. Just, and even, no words even, but if you have to speak things like, I'm so, so sorry. This is so hard. I'm here with you. Can we do that, Grace Family Church? The second thing we can do to embrace the resurrected life here and now is to seek, to sob and to seek. And when I say seek, I mean seek out the person of Jesus. Look, listen for his voice, his spirit, his guidance. And then here's the real kicker, follow his example. You know, when Jesus wanted to go back to Judea, the disciples were like, are you crazy? They're going to kill you. But Jesus went anyway. Because Jesus always ran towards the pain, towards the challenge, towards hurting people, not away. And it put him into dangerous situations. In fact, in the end, it got him killed. But here's the point. If Jesus ran towards the danger, if we are called to seek him and to follow him, to be his disciples, then surely we should be the kind of people who do the same. That's what Thomas and the other disciples did. Okay, fine. Let's go die with Jesus. And you know what? If you read the history books, that's exactly what they did. Thomas was crucified upside down. Most of the disciples were beheaded or martyred for their faith. Now I sometimes, you know, hear Christians and they're like, you know, Tom, the music's so loud and this aircon and the coffee line, oh my goodness. And I'm just like, guys, come on. Come on. The Christian life is not a life of mediocrity, nor is it a life of complacency. You and I were not made for a life of safety and self-protection. That is not the kingdom life. We were made to take risks for God's glory, to reach out to those in need, to be God's hands and feet, to be salt, which means to bring out the God flavors of this world, to be light in dark places, which means going into dark places. This is what it means to seek, to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus. And sometimes people will say to me, you know what, Tom, it's great that you're into this whole religion thing, but I just think Christianity is so boring. And I want to say to them, and I get it, I used to think that, but I want to say to them now, that's because you're not doing it right, dude. Because honestly, if you're genuinely seeking after Jesus, I'm telling you, it is adventurous, it is challenging, and it is sometimes terrifying. And let me say this. Following Jesus has nothing to do with your knowledge or with your ability or even with your personality. Or I'm just not like that. I don't like to talk to people about my faith. No, no. The disciples were super average people. You get this, right? I mean, you could argue they were below average. Serious. I mean, there's one part in the scripture where they're so surprised at these oaks preaching because it says, we were surprised because we knew them to be unschooled idiots. That's the Greek translation, idiotis, okay? And they were unschooled idiots, but I'll tell you what, they were committed unschooled idiots. And you know what? They went on to change the course of human history. God can use your obedience far more than he can use your intelligence. God can use your obedience far more than he can use your talent. Now, talent and intelligence are important and God will use them, but obedience is far more useful in his hands. So seek Jesus, read his word, listen to his promptings, do the right thing even when no one's looking. Reach out to people, invite them to church. That's scary, right? Tell people the story of what Jesus means for you, has done in your life. Visit people in hospital. Give your money away to worthy causes. Make sacrifice. Serve the poor. Run towards the pain, not away from it. And then we truly are following Jesus. Still with me? Final point, then I'm going to wrap this up. We're going to take communion together. Sob, seek. You're going to love this one. It's not what you think, okay? Strip. Don't put that on the screens for too long. Okay, here's where it comes from. I told you I had to squeeze the last S in. But Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth and his face wrapped in a cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Some versions say, "Unstrip him and let him go." Like I said, so many people walking around these days, dead men, dead women walking. And even in this room today, if you're honest with yourself, there are some of you, you've been raised to life by Jesus, but you're still walking around in your grave clothes. Still trailing behind your past hurts, strips of unforgiveness and resentment, bandages of brokenness and unresolved sin or bitterness, destructive patterns of behavior that seem to cling to your skin. And I mean, to be honest, we're all in this place in some way, shape, or form. All of us are still working out our salvation with fear and trembling, right? We're all a work in progress, stumbling towards the reality of the person that God has already declared us to be. And that's okay. We're a work in progress. But don't let that be an excuse, or don't let that stop you from stripping off, as Paul writes, every weight that slows us down, every sin that so easily entangles. Unbind him and let him loose, says Jesus. And he says it to Lazarus, but I believe he says it to us as well. Why? So that we can run the race that God has set before us. And all of us have a race set before us. And so strip. And I don't know what that looks like for you. You got to figure that out. Here's some examples. See a counselor. Get help. Let go. Forgive. Say you're sorry. Out yourself. Do you know how freeing it is to out yourself? Hey, I've got this problem. Because then there's no shame. You just take all the power of shame away. Hey, did you hear what so-and-so, he's having? I did. He talks about it openly and freely. No shame. Untangle the things that are holding you back. It's not going to be easy, but I promise you it will be worth it. Like I said, in the end, Lazarus still died. But this story is not about cheating death. It's about living life. And you know what? Before Lazarus died in the end, before that, I'm sure he had stories to tell about Jesus. And I'm sure before he died in the end, he told people about what Jesus had done for him. And I'm pretty sure lives were changed because of his testimony. We're all going to die one day. What matters more than when or how we die is how we live. That is the resurrected life. Here and now. Now and not yet, but available to all who would receive it. So I'm going to ask the band to come up, and we've got a few more minutes, and we're going to take communion together as a community, and there are tables right here in the front, there are tables in the middle, and whenever you're ready, the band are going to come up and just sing over us, and there are tables at the back as well. Everyone's invited to participate at the communion table as a reminder of what Christ has done for us. You see, in always and in all things, Jesus is our perfect example. Jesus wept. He showed us it's okay to be not okay, to be broken by the brokenness of our world. In fact, I would argue if you're not broken by what's happening in our world, I would pray the prayer, God, break my heart for what breaks yours. Jesus wept. Jesus ran towards danger. ultimately towards his own death on the cross for our sake. And that is what communion represents, his body broken and his blood shed for us. A God who was willing not just to be with us in our pain, but to take on our pain for our sake so that we might have life and have it in all its fullness. And Jesus took off his own grave clothes so that we could too. And that's the final little point. I love this. God kind of showed this to me this week. There's this little detail that when the disciples went to the tomb on that Easter morning, what did they find in the tomb? The only thing they found in the tomb was the folded grave clothes. Unlike Lazarus, those clothes were not left. Those clothes were left behind, wrapped up, folded, and the kerchief around his head, a very symbolic piece of garment, was folded separately from the rest as a sign, as a symbol. Those were the only thing of value in the tomb that anyone would have stolen. It was a symbol to signify that the body was not stolen, but rather that he had risen indeed and conquered death. Do you get it? Jesus sobbed. Jesus came to seek that which is lost. And Jesus stripped off death once and for all. And it's why we call him Lord and Savior. It's why we love him, because Jesus will never ask us to do anything that he hasn't already done for us. And that is why we trust him. That is why we can trust him. I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet and prepare your heart as we take communion together. In your own time, please don't rush off. We've got time. Just make your way to one of the tables. Make your way back to the chair. And when you're ready, you can take communion in your own time. And then we're going to just close the service off after that. But I started this message by asking you this question. Are you tired of waiting? And I'll end this message by giving you Jesus' answer one final time. You don't have to wait. I am, right now, resurrection and life. Let's take him. Oh, what a Savior. Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice you made on the cross for us. Your body broken, your blood shed for us. Lord, I pray for every person in this room who finds themselves in a tomb of a sort, in a place of death. Lord, thank you that you declare, remove the stone. Unbind us and let us loose. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead now lives in us. And so, Holy Spirit, come and have your way in us, Lord. Help us to sob, to grieve, to acknowledge the pain, to run towards the pain. Lord, we need your help. We need your Spirit. We need your guidance. We need your presence. We need your power. So have your way in us, we pray. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Have a great week. We'll see you next time.